Thank you for joining with us for today's worship. We pray that you will be blessed through this time of worship and listening from God's Word. Join with us as we enter into a time of meaningful worship.
Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, born of Mary, baptized by John, have mercy on us.
We magnify you, O Lord Jesus. You are our King, the only begotten Son, Word of the Father, immortal in nature without change. Born of Virgin Mary, you became man for the salvation of mankind, crucified for our sins, buried and rose again. Thus you broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under your feet. You, Lord Jesus, are the one in Holy Trinity, worshipped and glorified, equally with your Father and the Holy Spirit. Have mercy on us.
Holy are you, O God.
Holy are you, Almighty.
Holy are you, Immortal.
Crucified for us, Lord Messiah, have mercy on us.
Holy are you, O God.
Holy are you, Almighty.
Holy are you, Immortal.
Crucified for us, Lord Messiah, have mercy on us.
Holy are you, O God.
Holy are you, Almighty.
Holy are you, Immortal.
Crucified for us, Lord Messiah, have mercy on us.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie
eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Peace be with you all.
And with your spirit.
O God of love and mercy, please enlighten our hearts with your glorious presence and grace. May we experience the fullness of joy and rejoice in your presence and your promise of resurrection from the dead. We'll always ascribe praise and thanksgiving to you and your Son and the Holy Spirit, as it was, is now, always will be, world without end.
Amen.
Let us join our voices in praise and worship our God.
be still. There is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms a fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to believe again. You are my refuge. You are my strength. As I pour out my heart,
all stand together.
Be still, there is a river that flows from Calvary's stream. A fountain for the thirsty. His grace watches over me. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to believe again. You are my refuge. You are my strength.
Of the glory,
you, for you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you.
With reverence, let us carefully listen to the reading of the Holy Word of God. We confess to you, O Lord, often our hearts are cold and our minds are preoccupied with the cares of this world. Please have mercy on us and help us to listen, discern, and obey your holy word. Hosho, pokus ban all mean.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 to 4. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I'll make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and the Lord went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran, the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is taken from Psalm 121. We'll read it responsibly, and the verse 8 we'll read together. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber.
Indeed, he watches over Israel, will neither slumber nor sleep.
The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand.
The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life.
The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us give attention to the reading of the epistle written by Apostle Paul to Romans chapter 4, verse 1 to 5, then verses 13 to 17.
Praise be to the name of the Lord of the Apostles.
Book of Romans.
Grant us the grace to discern and understand your holy word.
What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, discovered in this matter? In fact, Abraham was justified by works. He had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, when a man works, his wages are not credited to him as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the man who does not work, but trusts God, who justifies the wicked, his faith is credited as righteousness. Verse 13. It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who live by law are heirs, faith has no value and the promise is worthless. Because law brings wrath, and where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all. As it is written, "I have made you a father of many nations." He is our father in the sight of God, in whom he believed. The God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. The word of God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Stand in reverence and listen to the reading of the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace be with you all.
May the Lord make us worthy to listen to his word.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, which proclaims life and salvation to the world as recorded by St. John chapter 3, verses 1 through 17.
Blessed is he who has come and will come again. Praise to the Father who sent him for our salvation. May his blessing be ever upon us.
In the days of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the Word of Life, God incarnate of Blessed Virgin Mary, he taught in this manner.
So we believe.
Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who came from God, for no one could perform these signs you are doing if God was not with him. Jesus replied, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless you are born again. How can someone be born when they're old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born. Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to the spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept my testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How can you will believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in them. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world from world through him. Peace be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Barkimon stauman galo.
Kurie laizon.
Let us pray to the Lord for his blessings and mercy.
Merciful Lord, have mercy on us.
Make us worthy, dear Lord, that we praise and worship you without ceasing. You are the one who forgives our sins and cleanses from all unrighteousness. You promised us to call on you and you will answer. Knock at your door of mercy and you will stretch forth your hands and save us. To you alone belongs glory, honor, worship. Hosho, bakul span all mean. May we always receive remission from our debts and forgiveness of our sins from our merciful Lord.
Merciful Lord, have mercy on us.
Feeble and sinners by nature, let us respond by saying Amen. Kadish Abo Kadisho.
Amen.
Kadish Pro Kadisho.
Amen.
Kadish Ruohayo Kadisho.
Amen.
Reverence and faith, let us affirm the creed of the church.
We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, for all things visible and invisible.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified, also for us under Pontius Pilate, he suffered and died, and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. He shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets and apostles.
We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the new life of the world to come. Amen.
The time for us to say the prayers for the people of God.
God our Father, we pray for the Universal Church. We pray for your servant, Dr. K.P. Ohanan, our Metropolitan. For all Episcopals, Vicar Generals, priests, deacons, missionaries, and all who give leadership to various activities of our church. O Lord, we pray for all that govern our country. Give them the grace to work for unity and peace and rule with justice and mercy.
Kurie eleison.
We pray for all the activities of our church that we may work with true passion to fulfill the great commission you gave to your church.
Kurie eleison.
Dear Lord Jesus, send your word of forgiveness and healing to all those who are in various spiritual bondages, sickness and sufferings. May they too will experience deliverance by believing in your name.
Luke's Gospel, chapter 10, starting with verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, What is written in the law? What is your reading of it? So he answered and said, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Then Jesus answered and said, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothes, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a certain priest came down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and he set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, 'Take care of him. And whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you.' So which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to him who fell among the thieves?" And he said, "He who showed mercy on him." Then Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is a very familiar passage, and we love to read and reflect on the story of the Good Samaritan. Often we get caught up in all the details and we miss sometimes the main point. One thing I would encourage you to do today is read through this passage several times, reflect on it, pray through it. There are quite a number of people in this passage. There is the expert in the law. There is Jesus. We can assume that there are the disciples with Jesus. There must be others, a crowd. We also assume there, because it says that the lawyer stood up to test Jesus. There must be other people testing Jesus also. There was the man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. There are the thieves, the robbers. There is a Levite, there is a priest, and there is the Good Samaritan. I heard a pastor explaining, it was more of a story, not a true, the story of a pastor explaining this passage to his congregation. And he said, "Today I want to tell you about the story of the Good Samaritan." And all the believers are looking and they're waiting anxiously. And he says, "Do you know who the Good Samaritan is?" They said, "No, we don't know. Do you know him?" "No, we don't know him." He said, "That is Jesus." Often we get excited about all the good explanations and everything, but there's a very simple point Jesus is making. This is the point. Anyone who is in need, who is suffering, who is struggling, do something to help them. That's it. Even if that person is your enemy, even if you find it difficult, do something to practice practically your faith, showing them the love of Christ. James says, "Show me your faith by words, and I'll show you my faith by action, helping the poor." That's the point Jesus is trying to make. But I want to point out a few things here so that we can reflect and meditate, and as we leave from here today, that we can think about this and also put into practice. This expert of the law, he knew the scriptures. He knew his theology. You can write down 2 verses. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, and Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, and Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18. When Jesus was tested by this man, and he said, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus simply said, "What do you think?" He said, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, strength. Second, love your neighbor as yourself. That's in the Old Testament. This man, he knew God's word. He knew theology. He knew all the right answers. And Jesus commended him and said, you spoke very well. Your understanding is correct. And Jesus said, now go and practice and you will do well. The lawyer, the expert, should have kept quiet, left it there. But instead, he wanted to justify himself, showing something. Pride was in his heart, and pride got him into trouble. Oftentimes, when we are not careful with our words, we will find that sometimes pride is in our heart. The Bible tells us in many places, pride comes before the fall. Even you can look at the example of David and Goliath. Goliath was very proud just before he fell. King Saul also struggled with that. Many struggle with that. And God is always at work to remove our pride. If this expert in law simply would have listened to what Jesus said, thank you, that's enough, I will go and pray, I will reflect, I will ask for God's mercy to help me to practice, it would have been fine. But pride made it that he said, who is my neighbor? Because this man asked the question, now we have the example of the Good Samaritan. One practical advice is when we see God speaking to us from his word, we hear the scripture being read, we are reading it, meditating on it, we hear a message or a teaching, listen carefully. Don't be satisfied simply with our knowledge, but say, Lord, would you take that and put it into my life? Holy Spirit, would you make it work practically in my life. Help me not to be satisfied simply with my knowledge, but I want this to work in my heart. This man that was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho, down the Jericho road, obviously was a Jewish man coming from Jerusalem. Some years ago, we had the opportunity to visit Israel. And we went to a high hill and overlooking the Jericho Road. It's a very windy and twisted road. It's a very good place for robbers and thieves, even today. Many hiding places. It's a very lonely road. So people would travel down this road, but it's a very dangerous road. That's why often people would travel together in groups. This man is not traveling in a group. He's by himself. The thieves beat him, steal from him, leave him for dead. Three people come. A Levite and a priest. They also know the scripture. Scripture is very clear. If you are a Levite or a priest, you should not touch a dead body. Otherwise, you become unclean. Maybe these men were on the way to conduct some service. They looked, maybe they felt sad, and they walked by. We don't know if this man was asking for help. The third person that came by was a Samaritan. Samaritans and Jews were not friends. Do you remember when Jesus met the Samaritan woman? John's Gospel, chapter 4. The disciples saw that they were talking, and even this woman was surprised and said, What do you have to do with me? I'm a Samaritan. Why, you, a Jew, are asking me for something? The Jewish community would take a very long journey around Samaria just so the dust would not touch their feet. There was such anger and hostility from the Jewish people and the Samaritans. And yet Jesus chose to make the hero of the story a Samaritan. This man takes the man, bandages his wounds, puts him on the donkey, takes him to the inn, pays his own money, and says, take care of him. And when I come back, whatever money you need more, I will give it. When you want to help someone, sometimes it'll cost our time. Sometimes it'll cost our money. Sometimes we may lose a meeting opportunity. Obviously, this man was on the way somewhere, lost his opportunity for his meeting. Helping someone will always cost us something. There are two types of people who give. One person gives expecting something back. I help you, next year you help me. But then there are those that we help, we give, we know that they cannot give back. Someone who is in great need, someone on the street, someone in a leprosy colony, they cannot give back. The Bible tells us if we give or we are helping with the expectation that they should give us back, then what have we done? I give you 10 rupees, you give me 10 rupees, and we go away happy. Nothing has happened. But if I can give someone something, not expecting anything back, I have blessed them. I have done something in the name of Christ that is honoring to God. Think about this. Even Jesus Christ, when he went to the cross of Calvary, he went to the cross for us. What can we give? We cannot give anything. We sing the song, he paid a debt I could not pay. I owed a debt I could not pay. Jesus paid everything for us. On the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus even says, when your enemy is there, bless him, give. If this is the way we are to love our enemies, how much more we should love those who are not our enemies? It's very challenging. But by God's help, we can do this. God will help us to do this. Jesus finished the story, turned to the man, the Jewish religious leader, and said, who was the neighbor? Who helped him? This man could not say the word Samaritan. He said, the one who showed mercy. Jesus revealed more than just understanding scripture. What was in this man's heart was that he had difficulty with someone else. And Jesus showed that you cannot practice the things of God and have animosity in your heart towards others. I remember hearing a story, I believe it's a true story, about Mother Teresa. There was some award that she was getting, very big recognition, very big award. I don't remember which award it was, but she came very late. She came very, very late to the ceremony. And people were a little bit upset. They were saying, Mother Teresa, you came very late for this award. We've been waiting for a long time to give this to you. She said, sorry, I was helping someone on the street. Her priority, more than the award, more than her knowledge, more than anything else, was practically her life demonstrating the life of Christ. The greatest challenge for us as believers is not if we understand the scripture, but can we practically demonstrate that to those that we meet? I always appreciate very much Bishop Simon John. No matter where he goes, he will always help the beggars. Even if he knows this beggar is cheating him, he will still give them money. And he will ask, what is your name? Where are you from? How come you're on the street? Do you know Jesus? I remember many years ago, some of our sisters from the seminary, during one of the times of going to the town to share the love of Christ with people, they came upon this very old man who was on the street. And they sat with him on the street. And they said, Grandfather, please tell us what happened. Why are you on the street? He said, I have some sons, I think 4 sons. And when I became a little bit older, these 4 sons got together and kicked me out of the house and took the property. And for more than 7 years, I've been living on the street. I have no one, I have nothing. You are the first people to sit with me in these 7 years, and to even ask my name. And these sisters sat for some time, asked him his story and his life, and prayed with him and blessed him. There are so many opportunities that God has given to us to bless those who are in need. I'll close with this story. It's not a good story, but it's a good reminder. I had the privilege to be in Nepal visiting our minor seminary there. And during one of the sessions, I taught on the Good Samaritan, the same passage. It was a wonderful teaching. My heart was encouraged. Everyone's heart was encouraged. We understood the passage. We were going to go and do the things of the Lord. On the way back, we were riding in the vehicle. And we saw that there was a motorcycle accident. A man had hit with a vehicle, and obviously his leg was broken. There was blood and everything there. So what did we do? Did we stop? No, we continued. Just half an hour before, I had preached this wonderful message. And we left him there. Now, the discussion we were having is, if we take him, the police will ask us why we took him. You know that's true. What happens if we take him and then we end up in more trouble with the police? So we went about, a half a kilometer. Then we decided, no, we should go back and pick the man up and take him to the hospital. By the time we came back, someone else took him. The rest of the ride was very quiet. It's good to understand, but it's more important to do something. Oftentimes, we are afraid to do something good because we are calculating what is the risk. Oftentimes, our calculation is the one thing that gets in the way. Will this bring dishonor to me? Will this shame me? What will other people say? And rather, we don't do anything good. Mother Teresa is Mother Teresa because she was willing to risk everything. I remember many, many, many years ago, our metropolitan saw this one man who was on the side of the road. Seeing someone on the side of the road one time is not a big deal. But after 4, 5, 6 days, the same man sitting in the same place, not moving, something is wrong. So he found out what happened to this man. What had happened is some vehicle had hit him, and he had been laying on the side of the road for many days. An old grandmother, Amachi, was bringing some rice to keep him alive, but he was struggling. So our metropolitan made the arrangement to take him to the hospital, pay his bill, visit him several times in the hospital, share the gospel with him, pray with him. Still, I remember that example. My brothers and sisters, It's one thing to read the story of the Good Samaritan, but let us now become the Good Samaritan and do something so that our life can bring others to Christ. Amen.
We bring the sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord.
We hope that you have been blessed by being part of this worship and learning from God's Word. We like you to come and be part of our service at Believers Church Cathedral, St. Thomas Nagar, Kuttapura PO, Tiruvalla. For further information, please contact us at the following numbers: 9446333987 or 9496426130 or at 9446441708. You can even email us at bccathedral@bc.org or send your prayer requests at the following email address: prayer@ay.tv. May God bless you all. Mercy, Lord, you feel